Hello and a very good evening. You're watching the news at 6 on Rajya Sabha Television with me, Frank Pereira. Here are this evening's headlines. Rajya Sabha witnesses uproar over governor's role in government formation in Goa. Deputy Chairman P.J. Kurian rules that discussion only after substantive notice is given. Trivendra Singh Rawat elected as BJP Legislative Party leader in Uttarakhand. The former state BJP chief will take oath as the chief minister tomorrow. Election Commission finds no merit in claims of EVM fraud by BSP Chief Mayawati and Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal assures that EVMs are totally tamper-proof. An airstrikes kill at least 42 people in a village mosque in northern Syria. Human rights body says the raids were carried out by unidentified warplanes. Well, the opposition Congress on Friday upped the ante against the government over formation of government in Goa. Congress members alleged breach of propriety in the state, a charge strongly refuted by the government. The Congress also forced a brief adjournment during Zero Hour. Let's take a look.
The government formation in Goa resonated again in the upper house on Friday. Congress leader Digvijay Singh tendered a notice under Rule 267 to take up the discussion on the Goa governor's conduct in inviting the BJP to form the government in the state. Leader of opposition Gulam Nabi Azad and CPIM leader Sitaram Yechury also sought to question the government on the issue.
Under Rule 267, where I have requested that the proceedings of the listed business of the house should be suspended because the gross constitutional impropriety has been committed by the governor of Goa.
Sir, I would like to bring it to your notice.
He has not raised the issue about the conduct of the governor. He has said what the governor has said in an interview. First of all, she has said that I did not expect it BJP to form the government. If she did not expect it BJP to form the government, that is her opinion. But simultaneously, she is saying that I spoke with the leader of the house, the finance minister, at 9:30 and asked him whether I should form the government.
Sir, you say that yes, the minister is answerable to the house.
Yeah.
Yes, separate notice will be given.
Yeah.
When that will be given, it will be accepted and the minister will have to answer.
No problem. Let a motion be given. Let them do, yes.
Deputy Chairman P.J. Kurian, however, disallowed Digvijay Singh's notice and asserted that a governor's conduct can only be discussed after a substantive motion is allowed.
I have to only caution you on one point.
Yes, sir.
See, you know the rules.
I know the rules.
That a governor can be discussed here only on the basis of a substantive motion. Not on 267.
Correct.
Therefore, the 267 I cannot allow.
MOS Parliamentary Affairs Mukhtar Abbas Naqvi hailed the chair's assertion and accused the Congress of insulting the people's verdict and also the chair's ruling.
Aapne ruling de diya ki if they want discussion, they can bring a substantive motion. Then they are questioning your ruling, number one. Pehle to janta ke janadesh pe question, phir aapki ruling pe question, phir desh ke logon ke janadesh ka apmaan. To hamari inse request ye hai ki agar ye house nahi chalana chahte, har din house mein disturb karna chahte, to wo bata de, hum us tarah se vyavastha karenge. Lekin house aur janta ke paise ka hum jo hai wo is tarah se pani mein daal nahi denge.
Congress members, however, continued their tirade against the government and trooped into the well of the house. The chair then adjourned the house till noon. Kriti Mishra's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
The government's decision of strategic sale of equity stakes in public sector undertakings drew flak from the opposition in the Rajya Sabha on Friday. The TMC and the CPIM warned of labour unrest if the government went ahead with the disinvestment plan.
Shukhendu Shekhar Roy of the TMC protesting against the strategic sale of India's first pharma company, Bengal Chemicals and Pharmaceuticals Limited. Raising the issue during Zero Hour, Shekhar asserted that BCPL made a profit of 1 crore rupees last year, and any strategic sale will lead to loss of jobs of thousands of workers. He also urged the government to review its decision.
In this way, the public sector companies are being sold out and thousands of laborers will be rendered jobless, not only in Bengal but in different parts of the country. Therefore, I would urge upon the government through you, sir, to review the decision for sale so that these companies are safe, because this Bengal Pharmaceutical is a first Swadeshi company of this country. It was established during Swadeshi movement when anti-partition movement was going on in 1905.
In another Zero Hour mention, CMP Sritabrata Banerjee sought the termination of the strategic disinvestment of Alloy Steel Durgapur. Banerjee said that the move will lead to job losses and add to the industrial distress in Durgapur.
Sir, I stand up here to voice the demand of the people of Bengal in general and Durgapur in particular.
Sir, only
to save the industrial city of Durgapur and stop the strategic disinvestment of Alloy Steel plant. The government has decided to strategically disinvestment the Alloy Steel plant. The Alloy Steel plant is one of the most important crowns of sale, which is capable of producing most special steels of nearly 500 varieties for use in missile technology, defense applications, submarines, research projects, neutrino experiment, high-speed railways and many other very soft.
BCPL and sales unit Alloy Steel of Durgapur are among the public sector units that the Niti Aayog has identified for majority stake sale in order to bring in greater efficiency and professionalism in their functioning. Kriti Mishra's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, Trivendra Singh Rawat will be the new Chief Minister of Uttarakhand. The decision was taken at the BJP legislature meeting in Dehradun today. A former RSS activist for nearly 20 years, Rawat won the Doiwala Assembly seat for the third time in the recently concluded Uttarakhand Assembly elections. He is also in charge of BJP's Jharkhand unit and is considered close to BJP President Amit Shah. BJP scored a massive victory in the Assembly elections, winning 57 out of the 70 seats. The swearing-in ceremony will take place tomorrow in capital Dehradun. Well, the new BJP government in Uttar Pradesh is likely to be sworn in on Sunday. Party sources said on Friday both Prime Minister Narendra Modi and BJP President Amit Shah will attend the event at the Smriti Upwan in Lucknow. The party is expected to name the new chief minister after a meeting of the BJP's legislature party tomorrow, with senior party leaders Venkaiah Naidu and Bhupendra Yadav attending as central observers. The newly elected BJP MLAs in Uttar Pradesh will meet on Saturday to elect their legislature party leader. The meeting is expected to be attended by central observers Venkaiah Naidu and Bhupendra Yadav. The new chief minister, along with his cabinet, will take oath at a ceremony on Sunday at the Smriti Upwan, Lucknow.
Itna kaam zarur karunga ki jo bhi tay ho jayega un sabko main parso 5 baje shapath dene ka kaam karunga.
According to media reports, senior BJP leader and union minister Manoj Sinha is the front runner for the post of chief minister in the state, although Sinha, who represents the Ghazipur seat in the Lok Sabha, has denied knowledge of the development so far. Speculation has also focused on union ministers Rajnath Singh, Smriti Irani, Mahesh Sharma and Kalraj Mishra for the chief minister's post. Other names include Lucknow Mayor Dinesh Sharma, National BJP spokesperson Shrikant Sharma, Gorakhpur MP Yogi Adityanath and State BJP Chief Keshav Prasad Maurya.
CM, aapko kal 4 baje tak aapko bata diya jayega vidhayak dal ki baithak mein ki CM kaun hoga. Uske pehle batane se ye hoga ki vidhayak dal ki baithak ka mahatva khatam ho jata hai.
Kendriya netritva Uttar Pradesh ke bare mein jo bhi faisla lega, sabhi log us faisle ke sath mein hain. Uttar Pradesh mein vikas aur sushasan ki sthapna ab lakshya hai.
All 312 MLAs of the BJP have been told to be present in the state capital on Sunday. Along with allies, the BJP has 325 MLAs in a house of 403 representatives. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha Television. Well, it's time for a short break now, but news and updates will continue on the other side. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Here also we use the isotope technique to understand the source of water. As So using the isotopic value, we can actually separate out how much rain you have got from the Bay of Bengal source, how much water you have got from the Arabian Sea, and how much water during the rainfall you have got from the recycling of the inland moisture.
Watch Eureka with Professor Prashanta Sanyal, Head of Department, Earth Sciences, ICER, Kolkata, on Rajya Sabha Television. Homai Vyarawala, better known by her pseudonym Dalda 13, was India's first woman photojournalist. Vyarawala entered the field of photojournalism in the late 1930s. For nearly 30 years, till she retired in the early 1970s, at the peak of her career, she made a massive impact. Vyarawala clicked some iconic pictures of political and national leaders. Gandhiji, Nehru, Jinnah, Indira Gandhi have been subjects of her vast photographic collection. Prime Minister Nehru, she says, was her favourite. In 2011, Homai Vyarawala was conferred the Padma Vibhushan, the country's second highest civilian award.
Welcome back, you're watching Rajya Sabha Television. Well, dismissing the claims of BSP Chief Mayawati and Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal about the reliability of electronic voting machines, the Election Commission has assured that the EVMs are fully tamper-proof as ever. In a strongly worded statement, the Commission said baseless, speculative and wild allegations are being made which deserve to be rejected. The poll panel said that it did not receive specific complaints or concrete material from political parties and candidates about alleged tampering of EVMs during recently held elections in the five states. It said the BSP's representation on EVM tampering was without any specific allegation. The EC's rebuttal came a day after Mayawati said she will move court against the alleged tampering of EVMs. Kejriwal too had alleged that EVMs may have been tampered with in Punjab. Meanwhile, turning down Kejriwal's proposal for ballot voting in the MCD elections, which are to be held on the 22nd of April, Lieutenant Governor Anil Baijal has confirmed the use of EVMs. He has conveyed to the Delhi government that the rules will have to be amended for shunning the EVMs and it was not possible to make the changes as little over a month is left for the polls.
This is not the first time some parties are raising doubts about EVMs or speaking about tampering of EVMs. In the past also such doubts were raised. In future also such doubts can be raised. So we'll have to settle it through some credible way.
हम चुनाव आयोग की बात से सहमत हैं कि tampering नहीं हो सकते. लेकिन हमारा कहना ये है कि अगर कहीं से ऐतराज आया, कोई शंका व्यक्त की, तो ये तो प्रजातंत्र का उत्सव है, उसके लिए उसकी प्रक्रिया है, उसको पर विश्वास पूरा होना चाहिए जनता को, सभी वर्ग को, तो उसको रूल आउट कराने में क्या हर्जा है?
Well, India has taken up the issue of two Indian clerics who reportedly went missing from Karachi with the Pakistani government. The clerics include 80-year-old Asif Nizami, the head priest of Delhi's Hazrat Nizamuddin Dargah. Nizami and his nephew Nazim Nizami were visiting the famous Data Darbar Shrine in Lahore. The clerics had earlier gone to Karachi to meet their relatives on March 8th before leaving for Lahore to visit the shrine. External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj said India has asked the Pakistani government to pursue the matter.
देखिए सरकार की तरफ से जहाँ तक ये संबंधित मंत्रालय हैं वो पूरा अपनी तरफ से काम कर रहे हैं और सरकार इस तरह के काम में ये चीज़ें जो है डाइवर्ज नहीं होती है, लेकिन सरकार अपना मुस्तैदी से पूरा का पूरा इसमें कार्रवाई कर रही है।
Let's now get you up to date with news from across the country in Nationwide. The Calcutta High Court has directed the CBI to conduct a preliminary inquiry into the Narda news sting operation within 72 hours. The High Court has also asked the Kolkata police to hand over all documents of the case to the CBI within 24 hours. Ahead of West Bengal's assembly elections in 2016, Narda News had released a sting operation involving 11 Trinamool Congress leaders and a senior police officer allegedly accepting bribes. While the TMC has alleged that the videos to be doctored, the Central Forensic Science Laboratory has proved them to be genuine. Calcutta High Court Judge Justice C.S. Karnan has rejected a bailable warrant which was served to him by the Supreme Court. The warrant was issued earlier this month and was handed to him today by senior police officers at his residence. However, rejecting the warrant, Justice Karnan said that he was being embarrassed by the top court. Justice Karnan is facing arrest in a contempt of court case. The O Panneerselvam camp has submitted a petition to the EC requesting allotment of AIADMK's twin leaf symbol to them for the upcoming RK Nagar pipe hole. The move comes a day after the Shashikala camp stake claim to the party's symbol. The poll panel has sought supporting documents from both factions before March 20th. The RK Nagar assembly seat fell vacant after the death of Jayalalitha last year. Well, India had a comeback of sorts with the ball on day two of the Ranchi test on Friday. The Indian bowling led by Ravindra Jadeja's second five-wicket haul of the series helped dismiss Australia for 451. The tourists were led by Captain Steve Smith, who remained unbeaten on an epic 178, becoming the first Australian and the fifth visiting captain to notch up a 150-plus score in India. India's reply was on par with Australia's. At stumps, they were at a wicket down for 120, trailing by 331 runs. KL Rahul led India's response with his fourth half century of the series. He was settling in well before Cummins caught him with a slow bouncer. Murali Vijay, who is playing his 50th test, supported Rahul well and came into his elements with KL Rahul's exit.
There you go again. This time the finger goes up.
Well, it's time for another quick breather on the program now, but we'll be right back.
The sacred relics of Buddha were unearthed in Pipravav in Uttar Pradesh. Buddha. Buddhist monks from all over the world visit the National Museum to pay their respects. These charred bone fragments of Buddha are housed in the gold canopy gifted by the royal family of Thailand.
Raju Ki Baoli, located in Mehroli, is considered the most ornamental of Baolis in the national capital. It was built by Daulat Khan during the reign of Sikandar Lodi in 1516. Raju refers to masons who used it. The entire structure is subterranean, so only the topmost story is visible as the visitor approaches. Walk towards its steps and each lower level slowly reveals itself. The top floor has a row of arched niches. There are three levels going down with 66 steps. The Baoli complex has a 12-pillar tomb and a mosque with plaster decoration on it. Carved brackets support the chajja below the parapet. There are rooms behind this arcade, meant for shade and shelter for visitors. The Baoli combines Islamic architecture with hints of Hindu engravings and geometric designs.
Welcome back. You're watching Rajya Sabha Television. Well, the United States military has denied carrying out an airstrike against a meeting of Qaeda militants on Thursday in Syria, also denying that a number of the extremists had been killed. The statement came as reports came out that a mosque had been bombed and that scores of innocent civilians had been killed and wounded. A spokesman for the United States Central Command said that the American aircraft had struck a nearby building but did not hit the mosque. The Syrian Observatory for Human Rights said that the airstrike took place in Al-Jinnah, a village between the cities of Idlib and Aleppo. It said 42 people had been killed, most of them civilians, and described the attack as a massacre. Well, Japan is preparing for any eventuality in the face of an increasing threat of a North Korea missile attack. It recently carried out an anti-missile drill in the town of Oga, which is the first in line to be hit if Pyongyang does send a missile. Meanwhile, the U.S. has said that a new approach is needed in dealing with North Korea.
A siren sounding over the fishing town of Kitara in Oga City, about 500 kilometers north of Tokyo. This is the nation's first civilian evacuation drill simulating a North Korean missile landing some 20 kilometers offshore into the Sea of Japan. A little over a week ago, North Korea had actually fired four ballistic missiles into the same waters, dropping one of them about 200 to 250 kilometers west of Oga. The largely rural Oga City has been Japan's front line against North Korea's missile threats since 1993, when Pyongyang began testing its 1,300-kilometer range Rodong missiles developed from Scud missiles with Soviet technology.
場合に対処について国民の皆さんの理解を進める必要があるというふうに考えておりまして、今回の訓練というのはそういう意味で極めて重要だというふうに思います。まあ、いろんな事態が考えられますし、その隣国の行動も予測できないと思いますので、いろんな場合に備えて備えをしっかりするということが必要なんだろうというふうに思います。
The drill comes soon after U.S. Secretary of State Rex Tillerson met with Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe on Thursday and suggested a new approach in dealing with North Korea.
Well, I think it's important to recognize that the diplomatic and other efforts of the past 20 years to bring North Korea to a point of denuclearization have failed. So we have 20 years of failed approach.
America's proposal found resonance with China, which said it was open to proposals in dealing with Pyongyang. China has already proposed that North Korea should stop its nuclear and missile tests, and South Korea and the United States should stop joint military drills and seek talks instead. The country also said it is open to proposals as long as they are conducive to maintaining peace and stability. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Well, let's now get you a roundup of the other international news and global buzz. A meeting of G20 finance ministers and central bank governors kicked off in the German town of Baden-Baden on Friday. The first session of the two-day meeting was opened by the German finance minister, who said that the protectionist stance of the new US administration could complicate the talks and force policymakers to leave out the disputed trade issue. A letter bomb that exploded at the International Monetary Fund office in Paris on Thursday was sent from Greece. The IMF employee who opened the letter received hand and face injuries and staff were evacuated. It came after a parcel bomb meant for German Finance Minister Wolfgang Schäuble was intercepted on Wednesday. Greek far-left group, the Conspiracy of Fire Cells, claimed responsibility for sending that letter. U.S. President Donald Trump's new $1.15 trillion budget is expected to reshape America's government, ordering generous increase for the military and slashing domestic programs. Trump's initial budget proposal submitted to Congress on Thursday would boost defense spending by $54 billion, the largest increase since Ronald Reagan's military buildup of the 1980s. Pakistan has urged social media giant Facebook and other media platforms to help in combating blasphemy while vowing to lead the fight against it. The move comes after Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif earlier this week ordered authorities to take immediate action against blasphemous content on the social media and remove sacrilegious content and punish the perpetrators days after a High Court order. Well, that's it on this newscast. Have a good evening.